Thank you so much, Peg, for that introduction, and thanks to you all for coming and having a lunchtime conversation with me about this research that I'd like to present to you. How many people ran the Boulder yesterday, by the way? All right, we have a few
Excuse
of us.
Me, I gotta go.
Congrats. Right here. How many of you were sitting on your porch applauding for the rest of us? Anybody? All right, thank you, thank you. It's always helpful to have the encouragement midway through. So what I'm going to talk to you a little bit about today started, the process of the research started actually while I was here in Boulder, a graduate student at the CU Boulder's Political Science Department. It was back in June 2006 that I was wrapping up my doctoral dissertation. It was on the topic of why political violence happens in democratic countries, despite the availability of lots of other ways to express one's political voice. And most of my research was related to the topic of violence, why it happens, how governments reduce it, basically trying to understand why people mobilize using lethal force against other people. And so, you know, having written my doctoral thesis on this, I'd just been immersed in about 4 years of literature on, you know, war, mass rape, repression, mass atrocities, mass killings. That was my bag, so to speak, research-wise. And most of what I did was trying to employ statistical techniques to trying to kind of understand why those things happen so often. And I was here, and I got an email from one of my colleagues named Victor Assal, who's a professor at SUNY Albany. And it was kind of a joke, the email. It said, the other side of the coin, ha ha. And it was an announcement for a workshop happening at Colorado College called People, Power, and Pedagogy. And it was a group called the International Center on Nonviolent Conflict, offering an educational seminar for social scientists about how to incorporate the topic of nonviolent civil resistance into the classroom. And to tell you the truth, as a graduate student, I was mostly motivated to apply to this workshop because of the free food and books, which, as you see, still motivates me today, or even just the food, right? So I applied to go to the workshop, and they let me in, and they sent me a box of books in advance by people like Gene Sharp, Peter Ackerman, Jack Duvall, Stephen Zunis, and a variety of other people who were talking about this thing called nonviolent civil resistance. Now, the way they were defining it was a lot different from the way I thought of nonviolence, which was they were defining nonviolent civil resistance as an active way of waging conflict where unarmed civilians used a variety of techniques like strikes, boycotts, protests, demonstrations, in coordination in order to directly confront and disrupt an opponent and create political change. And that was different from the way I had thought of nonviolence, which was basically more a moral philosophy or a point of view that eschews violence because of principles rather than because of necessarily its strategic applications. So I went to this workshop, and I was the skeptic in the room. And people kept bringing up cases like Serbia, where in 2000, students in the OTPOR movement helped to overthrow Slobodan Milosevic. And they were bringing up cases like the People Power movement in the Philippines and a variety of other cases where nonviolent resistance seemed to do what years of violent insurgency hadn't been able to produce in those countries. And I kept thinking, well, for every case of success you guys can think of, I can think of like Tiananmen Square. I can think of any number of other cases where people tried to do the same thing and were completely slaughtered, actually, by the authorities. And I can also think of lots of cases where violent insurgency worked really well, like the Russian Revolution, or the Algerian Revolution, or the American Revolution, or the French Revolution. So I was kind of frustrated, and I had a few other key reservations, which I'm going to call common claims because I hear people repeat them all the time. So my first reservation was that I didn't think that it was possible for unarmed civilians to actually achieve political change if what they were trying to do was confront a very repressive opponent with overwhelming military superiority over them, or an opponent that was so restricted in terms of its civic space that there was no possible way to organize politically. So that's very repressive, very powerful, or very authoritarian regimes. The second reservation I had was that I didn't think civil resistance could work if what people were trying to get was really hard. So maybe it's okay if you want a policy changed in your country, or if you want to reform something in your country, but if you're trying to unseat an incumbent dictator, for example, or you're trying to create a new territory or a new country through secession, or expel a foreign colonial power or military occupation, those are the types of political outcomes that I had usually associated with violent insurgency. So I didn't think that those were going to be very effective. That summer, there was a guy named Max Abrams who published an article in the journal International Security that was called Why Terrorism Does Not Work. And in his article, he makes the claim that when he counted up all the different terrorist organizations that were designated as such by the US State Department, he could identify only 7% of them had ever succeeded in achieving their political goals. On the last page of his article, he says, why does terrorism happen so much, given that it's so ineffective? And he speculated, speculated that at even just 7% effectiveness, it was probably still more effective than nonviolent protest. So that was kind of my mindset going into this workshop, that we're talking about something with very low and probably random possibilities of success. And usually if it succeeds, it's because the other side was so weak or lame that they couldn't fight back. So there was this woman there named Maria Steffen, who at the time was working for this educational foundation, and we were randomly put together as roommates. We were up into the night arguing about whether civil resistance was effective. At the end of the week, we decided to more or less make an intellectual bet and find out which one of us was right. And I said, if we're gonna do this, what we have to do is count like over a very long span of time, so like 1900 all the way up to today, we have to look at every country in the world, and we need to count the number of times people mobilized using civil resistance, and we need it to be against the most difficult things to achieve. So anti-dictator, anti-colonial power, military occupation or secession campaigns. So none of these civil rights movements. We're going for the big apples here. And so what we did was we collected these data over that entire time span of those types. We looked at the correlates of war data set. Has anybody ever heard of correlates of war data set? So what this is we've been counting, we being political scientists, have been counting armed conflicts for years and years. It's like what we do. And so we know if there was a violent conflict since like 700 to today, we've counted it. We know how many people died. We know what it was about, between whom. We know a lot about those. So I went to those cases, and I only looked at the cases where there were at least 1,000 armed insurgents engaging in one of these types of campaigns in that country for one of those goals. Then I looked for the correlates of nonviolent conflict data set, and there was no such thing. So we had to actually build that data for 2 years from scratch. This is why we're academics, because we'll take an intellectual bet and then spend 2 years of our lives trying to investigate it and discover the results. So we went back through all of the different kind of historical documents available to academics, case studies, historical studies of revolution, protests, you name it. And we went back and collected hundreds of cases from 1900 to 2006. We then circulated the list to every of the sort of top 12 experts on this topic around the world to ask them to identify any cases we accidentally left off and also to evaluate whether it was successful or failed. We defined success very strictly. The campaign had to have achieved what it said it wanted within a year of its peak. It had to have had a discernible impact on that outcome such that we couldn't imagine the outcome happening without them. So for example, if a dictator had a heart attack in office, we didn't code that as a success, even if you could make the claim that the heart attack might have been related to the stress of facing a campaign, we still didn't code that as a success. So we applied a very strict criteria to both nonviolent and violent campaigns. Also, the campaign had to achieve what it said it wanted, so fully removing the dictator from power, not just achieving, you know, elections where then they could vote for who they wanted, not de facto autonomy, but de jure legal secession and independence as countries go. So that's all the sort of necessary details you need to know about the scope conditions of what I'm about to present. And what we found is that Maria, my colleague, Maria Steffen, was actually the one who was right on with her hunch that actually from this period, from 1900 to 2006, nonviolent campaigns were actually twice as likely to achieve their goals as violent insurgencies. Another thing that's very interesting is this slide, which shows you over time that nonviolent resistance has basically supplanted violent insurgency in terms of the frequency of onsets from about the 60s forward. What we're witnessing is this trend where violent resistance is going out of style and nonviolent resistance is actually on the rise. And it's increasing in its effectiveness. So this slide shows you the relative success rates of both nonviolent and violent resistance over time. And what you can see is that basically from the 1960s on, nonviolent resistance has actually been more effective in achieving those goals. This is full success here that we're looking at. You can see that from 2010 on, we see a decline, but part of that is because we have a lot of ongoing campaigns and we code those as failures as of the end of 2014. So actually what I would point you to is the cases that end by 2010, and you can see that the effectiveness is incredibly striking of these campaigns. So why would that be? For a person like me, who always expects violence to have really good kind of strategic reasons behind it, this is a real puzzle. And when we actually dug into the data and we looked at these different observations, what we found is that the power of civil resistance inheres in its ability to attract large and diverse participants from many different sectors of society, who then are able to translate their participation into real leverage toward campaign results. This is a slide that shows the way that the number of participants in a campaign affects the probability that that campaign succeeds. These are from the data collected for the book. The horizontal axis you can't actually interpret directly because it's a logarithmic scale. But basically what this is showing is the more people per population are participating in a campaign, the more likely it is to succeed. You see that on the vertical axis.
Is it now, sheer numbers?
Yeah, proportion of the population. So the real kicker is there was this guy named Mark Lichbach, who's an economist, who speculated in the 90s what he called the 5% rule, that no government could withstand a challenge of just 5% of its population. We actually found in our data that none of the campaigns failed after achieving 3.5% popular mobilization. So he was really close. He actually didn't test his argument on the data, and that's what our data say. So the 5% rule is close. The other, you know, that's people directly observed participating. So usually if you're going to achieve that level of direct participation, you have a very large level of latent support as well. Now here's the real kicker. Nonviolent campaigns of civil resistance are on average 11 times larger as a proportion of population than the average armed insurgency. So why do nonviolent campaigns get so big? We think there are basically four different reasons for this. The first is simply a lower physical barrier. Now, unless I'm running the Boulder, I don't love running 10Ks. I hate it, actually. I actually really hate it when somebody's running behind me screaming that I have to run faster. That's why I dropped out of Army ROTC in college. Like, I hated being told I had to run faster. And, you know, physical activity is really necessary for any type of successful organized armed activity. And so because of that, we see that the people who are typically drawn to active confrontation in armed conflict are young, able-bodied men. There are cases where women are directly involved and so forth, but the probability that they will be goes down when the campaign becomes an armed insurgency. For nonviolent resistance, there are a variety of techniques available that are extremely disruptive, but much more amenable to participation with people with lower risk profiles. For example, the stay-at-home demonstration. It might not sound like much, but when 3 million people sit on their couch for 3 days instead of going to work, it completely cripples an urban economy. So you don't need any physical ability, actually, except maybe some, you know, moving around on the couch. And you need to get up every once in a while for, you know, nature calls. But basically, there's very little physical activity that's required. There's definitely physical risks, but they're not going to be imposed from you yourself. So the second lower barrier to participation is a lower commitment barrier. And here we don't mean that people are less committed to a cause when they join nonviolent resistance. It's often quite the opposite. But the thing here is that to get into a nonviolent campaign, all you have to do is look outside your window and you see how you join. To get into an armed campaign, it's actually kind of difficult in some societies for people to figure out how they join. When they do join, they're often asked to commit murder of somebody on the opposite side to demonstrate that they aren't informants. Once they do that, they can't leave the group. The group becomes their protection for the rest of their life. And so it just means that joining an armed insurgency brings a host of different life changes to somebody's world in such a way that it discourages kind of casual insurgents from joining. Nonviolent resistance, casual insurgents are welcome. And in fact, they usually don't have to give up their day job in order to participate. There's also lower informational barriers, and this relates to the visibility of different techniques of nonviolent action. That, like I said, the look out your window effect is how you would self-recruit or volunteer into a nonviolent campaign, whereas for armed insurgencies, you have to go through a series of kind of networks, through your personal network, through your family network, to figure out who knows somebody who can get you in. And that just means that, again, it discourages casual participation. The final lower barrier to participation is just a lower cognitive barrier, which is to say that mercifully, human beings have developed different inhibitors in their brains to committing offensive armed action. Now, this is why when people do join militaries or they do join an ordinary armed activity, there are often sustained periods of training that basically teach people to override their hesitation to kill. We're glad we have the hesitation to kill. It's what means that when one of you kind of makes me mad during Q&A or something, I won't run across the table and kill you. I'll just count to 10 and, you know, work it out. But, you know, we do have to override that if we're going to engage in organized armed activity, and we don't have to if we're engaged in nonviolent resistance. The reason why these numbers matter is because people power activates a number of different points of leverage in the society that make it unsustainable to maintain the status quo. So this is the civil resistance model that's suggested by the theorist Gene Sharp. The argument here is that every single power holder, no matter how awful, brutal, and authoritarian they are, is 100% dependent on the cooperation, obedience, and help of people that reside in various pillars of their support. So this is security forces, police, economic elites, business elites, intelligentsia, the state media, religious authorities, and the like. They all reside in these different pillars of support. They also live in the society. They have neighbors, they have friends, they have family members, and when those people start to engage in mass withdrawal of obedience and support from those pillars, they can start to make people in those pillars question their own long-term interests. So a very concrete example of this happened in Serbia, where when hundreds of thousands of people were descending on Belgrade in October 2000 to demand that Milosevic leave office, there were a number of activists that had actually stolen radios from the police. And they were listening to the police channel when they got the order to shoot on the demonstrators. They could see that when the order came down, some of the police just stood there, other ones kind of looked around to see what their friends were doing, and they just completely pretended they didn't hear it. That's what we would call defection. Defection in the sense that they disobeyed the ruling authority. Afterward, many scholars had the opportunity to interview these police and other internal security forces and ask them, why didn't you follow the order? And most of them said things like, I saw my kids in the crowd, or I was afraid my kids would be in the crowd, or I saw the guy who sells me liquor on Saturday, and I didn't want him to stop selling it to me. You know, like people thinking about, okay, I could follow this order now and, you know, not lose my job, or I could think about the long-term interest of what my life might look like a year from now, and what my kids' life might look like a year from now, or my wife's life, and I don't want to be totally uncomfortable as I go shopping, so I'm just going to pretend I didn't hear that. Now, that kind of process we see is actually kind of common. Where security forces just refuse an order at a critical point, it creates a political crisis. This was kind of theorized, as I mentioned, by Gene Sharp. We put it to the data. And what we actually found is that the larger a violent campaign gets, There's actually not a huge impact on the probability that security forces defect, that is, disobey an order or even join into the opposition. But you can see that the larger a nonviolent campaign gets, the probabilities that security forces defect actually increases quite a lot. It doubles from the smaller to the largest nonviolent campaigns, and it's more than double the probability for the largest violent campaigns, for the largest nonviolent campaigns. And if you think about that, it makes sense. Because if I'm one of the security forces and people start shooting at me, my training's going to kick in and I'm going to just defend myself and my unit. Whereas if people are like sticking a rose in the end of the barrel of my gun, I have to think about it for a second about what my long-term interests are. So of course, sometimes they shoot. And we see that in a number of different cases. But what we found that was pretty shocking for me is that even in those cases where there's lethal repression against the nonviolent campaign, it's still a 2-to-1 advantage over the violent ones. And we think there are two major reasons for this. The first is that there's a generalized pattern that when security forces unleash lethal force on unarmed people, it's more likely to backfire. Backfire is simply the process where the intended effect of one's action is the opposite of what actually goes on. So if you're trying to shoot on 100,000 people to make them demobilize, the next day so many people are angry that 500,000 people turn out. That would be a backfire effect. And we know that there's a generalized pattern that the necessary condition of moral outrage or the perception that the repression is unjust, excessive, or disproportional is more likely to occur when the government represses unarmed people than when it represses armed people. The second thing that we think is happening is what I think is more important, actually, is that repression is costly. And it's really difficult to sustain over a long period of time. So if you think about that 5% rule again, that if just 5% of the population mobilizes, that a government can't survive, and then we pull that down to 3.5%, then it's really telling us a lot about what actual government capacities there are. It's very difficult to repress all the people all the time. And a very large campaign has such a wide variety of techniques available at its disposal that it can really throw off the ability to sustain repression. Here, for example, is what we would call a method of concentration. This is where people come together. They assemble mass at a decisive point in the conflict. It's disruptive. It makes for great front page pictures. But it's not necessarily the most effective technique, especially if all you do is that technique, because the other side can simply surround the people and it begins to elevate the level of risk for participation. Some movements switch to what's called methods of dispersion. And when movements are very large, they can actually stay away from places they were expected to go. And that becomes really costly. These are a bunch of security forces in Kashmir that are policing what they thought would be a mass demonstration, but turned out to be a general stay-at-home strike and demonstration. They're getting paid overtime, probably, for standing out there looking like idiots because they fell for a trap, which was an announcement of a huge public demonstration that turned out to be them standing there in the heat with nobody in sight. An example of how this was very critical, this switch between concentration and dispersion, comes from the Iranian Revolution. And this was the one from 77 to 79, which before the actual purges that occurred in the context of the kind of consolidation of the new regime, was actually a large popular nonviolent struggle. 10% of the Iranian population participated. It was huge. The largest violent revolution that had been observed before that was the French Revolution at just 2%. So imagine that being, you know, five times bigger than the most popular revolution on the books. So the Iranian Revolution was this huge struggle for about 100 days. There was the peak of the crisis. For the first 90 or so days, there were demonstrations, funeral processions, and so forth. People were getting mowed down in the thousands in the streets by the security apparatus. The Shah was, you know, ordering them to use lethal force and so forth. In the last 10 days, it looked like it was unsustainable, so they convinced the oil workers in the countryside to go on strike. They paired it with a stay-at-home demonstration, which would have been safer for them. So the internal security forces went door to door, pulled the oil workers back out onto the streets, marched them to the oil fields, and when they got there, they worked at half pace. The next day, same story. They stay at home, security forces go door to door, march them back on the streets, they go to the oil fields, they work at half pace. After 4 or 5 days of that, security forces started calling in sick. Why is that? Because they didn't like going in door to door. It's a very personal kind of repression. And they didn't think they were gonna get their overtime because the oil fields weren't pumping like they should be. Now, their overtime was actually coming from a very large reserve, and there was plenty of money left, actually, but they didn't know that, and the Shah had to fly out of the country within a couple of days. So you can see how the shift in methods of struggle for very large campaigns make them advantaged even in the context of a very committed, willing, and repressive regime. Lots of people ask me about external support. One of the very cynical kind of expectations about these campaigns is they only work if they're like against people the United States doesn't like or if they get the United States to support them. And actually what we found is that certainly for armed campaigns, external support is effective in helping them win. It increases their average chances of success by about 15%. But it had no net impact on the success rates of nonviolent campaigns. We think this is because, again, the power of these campaigns comes from their vast numbers. And if countries are giving them direct financial support, it might depress those numbers because of just incentives to free ride or by delegitimizing the leadership of the campaign in the eyes of the domestic public. So we know that violent insurgency sometimes works. It works about 23% of the time. And so the question is, at what cost? Well, for one thing, there's a major humanitarian cost. There are way more people killed in the average armed insurgency than in the average nonviolent campaign, even when the state represses it. The second is actually an impact on what kind of country emerges after a violent campaign compared with a nonviolent one. This is a chart that shows you data about the type of country that emerges, whether it's a democracy or not, 5 years after the campaign is over. On the horizontal axis is a 21-point scale called the polity scale. A negative 10 indicates a totalitarian regime, and a plus 10 indicates the most kind of advanced consolidated democracy. Now, the middling regions here, the negative 5 to 5, we consider kind of anocracies or hybrid regimes. They've got some elements of democracy and some elements of authoritarianism. So this horizontal axis tells us what was the country a year before the campaign ended. And then this is showing us the probability that it will be a democracy that is a plus 6 or higher just 5 years after the campaign ends. What we see for violent campaigns is that the most authoritarian regimes basically stay that way. You can see that the probability that it's a democracy goes up slightly as we move through the middle, but here's the really chilling outcome here, is that even for the most consolidated democracies, the plus 10s, only 50% chance that they will remain that way 5 years after the campaign is over. So democracies are collapsing when they face violent insurgencies. For nonviolent campaigns, we see a completely different picture. The negative 10s to negative 5s, the authoritarian regimes are already 10 times more likely to be democratic 5 years after. As we move through anocracies, you can see that the proportion really increases quite a lot, and then it's almost unheard of that democracies collapse 5 years after in the face of a nonviolent campaign. Why is that? Has anybody read Robert Putnam's book, Bowling Alone? Or Making Democracy Work. So in these books, what he argues is that civic associational life is absolutely crucial to a robust democracy. This group right here is so needed for democracy. Without groups like this, democracies collapse. Because the more engaged the population is, the more responsive policymakers are to their demands. And it's like the oil that keeps a democracy working through its institutions. If you imagine in countries where there is no such civic associational life, civil resistance is like that, but on steroids, right? Because imagine if then all of you got together and you went out and you took incredibly high risk, nonviolent action to effect a major political change in our society. That would create bonds and it would create a sense of nonviolent conflict resolution and civic engagement that the society would really need to emerge democratic. Whereas armed resistance campaigns kind of are basically fundamentally elite-based activities with martial values. And so, of course, that's what they're going to install afterward. We also find that that nonviolent campaigns are much less likely to be followed by a civil war outbreak within the next 10 years. So in the long term, not only are these societies more likely to have democratic institutions, but they're also less likely to succumb to renewed civil war. So for scholars, this brings up all kinds of really troubling problems, which is maybe we've been conceiving of power and force entirely in the wrong way for the past 80 years. And that power might not be who has the most guns, but actually more who has the consent and legitimacy of the most people. And when those people withdraw their consent from what they see as an illegitimate power holder, that it can affect, you know, world-affecting change. We also see that we ought not necessarily talk about civilians as just like victims to loot or, you know, always resources to loot in a crime or in a conflict, but actually instead that they might be active agents in the process of how a conflict unfolds in their country. And so we're sort of thinking a lot about all of the assumptions about how things are impossible different places, like nonviolent resistance in X country, it'll never happen. We used a variety of different techniques to try to isolate structural conditions that make this impossible, and we couldn't find any. So these campaigns are emerging like in every different type of country under all kinds of different circumstances. It appears that people are actually deciding how they want their conflicts to go rather than it being forced upon them. So for policymakers, it brings up a number of really interesting questions as well, and I think for us too, even if we're not directly policymakers. The first is the question of whom do we support in a conflict? Well, if the US really means what it says, that democracy promotion and rights-respecting regimes with low humanitarian costs is what's in our interest, then arming rebel groups that are already armed is probably not the best policy. It's just inconsistent with the empirical outcomes that we're observing here, that we're going to get democracies with low humanitarian costs and that respect human rights in the longer term if we give them support. So the question then is, okay, whom do we support and how? Because when we give money to nonviolent campaigns, it doesn't seem to do much for them, and in fact, today might really hurt them. So what I'm going to propose is that we think more about civilian instruments. Like, look at the tools that our society actually has at its disposal outside of the governmental level or the embassies. Like, what if we had a bunch of people who actually know how to do nonviolent resistance get in touch with people that are trying to do that in their country and share skills and knowledge and experience and sort of deploy the amazing insights that our citizens have and their own experience with others, or that other people teach our citizens how to do these things? So there are lots of other tools that I think we're not tapping into that might be promising alternatives to just supporting the next group that comes up, says it needs more weapons to wage its struggle. So with that, I hope we have plenty of time for you to you know, challenge this set of views, insult me, that's fine. We've had that and a variety of other questions and conversation. Yeah.
Thanks, Erica, it was great. So great. Taking all that high-powered analysis, how would you apply that to our fact pattern today in America? America, which has basically hollowed out its middle class and continuing, arguably moving from a democracy to a plutocracy. We all see that. And you see, arguably, a disaffected military potential. Veterans who are disenfranchised, disaffected, just not being reintegrated very elegantly into society. Maybe it's because I just watched a wonderful documentary on the French Revolution, and 2 days before Bastille, everything looked so calm and collected. I was very surprised by your 2%, if I heard you right, only 2% in the French Revolution actually were the insurgents.
Yeah.
So anyhow, applying all that, project 10 years to America. How do you see us going? Because the pressure point seems so, so obvious in terms of where we're going.
Yeah,
great. It's like tectonic plates moving. How is it going to manifest, do you think?
Yeah. So I think that there are a couple paradoxes around civil resistance and democracies. The first is that because we have elections, most of the most robust mobilization every 4 years gets channeled into the election cycle.
Can I just challenge you a little on that? You could look at elections almost like a show,
right,
that the real instruments of power don't really care about the outcome of an election. And you see all the money in politics now. Mm-hmm. The estimation, we went from $2 billion in 2012 presidential election. The forecast is $5 billion for 2016.
Yeah.
And you see this incredible gap in wealth.
Right. So
I just wanted to challenge you on that one point.
Yeah, well, so I think you're right, but I think most Americans still don't buy that. And so they do think, well, you know, I need to basically exercise my right to vote every 4 years, and that's how I participate. You're always going to have a small number of people who are willing to do more than that. But I'll tell you, like, when you have the moveon.orgs and stuff, what happens to them is that they get really excited about particular events or issues. A whole bunch of people start mobilizing, and then guess what? 3 years into it, they're like, you guys, we have to keep the worst guy out of the White House. So they're like back into the presidential election cycle. So all of the energy that builds up around particular issues like money out of politics basically has to be set aside for a while people go and work on the presidential election. It's a real challenge for any movement to sustain the energy and to really have key progressive issues that they're pushing through those times and maintaining momentum through those times, I think. The second thing is that actually what we've become is, in these sort of advanced democracies, we've become really used to protest. And protest is like what people do. And it's so normal now that I don't even know that you could count it as civil disobedience anymore. So then it brings up the question of, okay, so what would an actual civil disobedience act be in a democracy? And how could you get 11 million Americans to do it? That's the 3.5% rule, 11 million Americans. So like, I don't know, like how many people have to actually engage in like chaining themselves to things in order to make it happen, as opposed to just standing in the streets and demonstrating. So, you know, part of it's understanding what the actual disruption would look like and how to get that many people involved in it. So, you know, if you think about the things that were necessary for these campaigns to win, it was people power. The numbers are the number one thing. The number two thing is that they maintain nonviolent discipline. So figure out a way to get 11 million Americans to do something and all agree that they can't smash things and burn things. The third thing is that they figure out a way to produce the loyalty shifts. They don't have to be in security forces. They can be in economic elites or whatever, but turn those, you know, activate those levers of power and start pulling them away from the power holders. And then the fourth thing is how they deal with repression and are they able to maneuver. So when repression happens against demonstrations, do people basically scatter and then do another demonstration? Or do they scatter, regroup, and then shift to some technique that's totally creative and disruptive, but different from a demonstration, you know? So those are the four things that need to happen in this country for there to be a movement. And I don't know what that's gonna happen around or whatever, but that's what I'd say. Yeah.
In the Middle East, we watched social media play a very large role, and I was in Saudi Arabia at the time of the Arab Spring, and I watched the young Saudis use Twitter.
Yeah.
And while they're not mobilizing yet, they are certainly going with the cognitive side. They're starting to inform each other what's going on. Do you see that playing a role in other movements, the social media aspect of it, the ability to mobilize, not mobilize, stay at home?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think that the peak at which social media helped movements more than governments, was at the second half of the 2000s. So like 2005 to 2010, 11. After the Arab uprising, I basically think governments are better at social media than movements in terms of using it for their own kind of predictive purposes and trying to understand how to manipulate the propaganda and discourse. So I think the time when kind of open source social media advantage movements is over. And in fact, I think more movements are starting to get off of it because they recognize, first of all, it completely exposes them and their identities and the leadership of these movements to the government. But the second thing is just that the surveillance that the government can use to sort of anticipate and then crush any even burgeoning activity is too dangerous. So in Russia, for example, they just released this this plan to use all of their version of Twitter and Facebook to create predictive modeling so that they could anticipate every action, right? All governments are doing that. It's not just Russia, but they're the ones who like to brag about it. So I think it's very difficult. One really hopeful thing, though, is that most of the trends that I've been talking about here started before the internet. And people were engaging in very effective civil disobedience long before there was any type of technology like that available. And so part of it is like getting people to go a little retro and learn some of the methods of communication that were used before that were much easier for movements to use without government intrusion.
Like Osama did, keep from getting caught.
Right, yeah. And in a way, he totally got unwired, right? And had to have
I got a question.
Okay.
First off, I just to give you a little background. I'm a three-time Vietnam vet, so to give you a little background where I might be coming from. In my opinion, I think you made some assumptions about violent and nonviolent as far as the people participating in that. I think primarily people don't participate because of fear. Fear is a very basic gut emotion. But if you start shooting them anyways, all of a sudden the fear that you're going to die anyways overrides that, and then all of a sudden you'll participate. So, I mean, that was just one comment I wanted to make about that. But the other thing is, I think I'm a businessman, too. I've been a businessman for 45 years, quite successful. I look at things through the eye of efficiency. Mm-hmm. If it's not working well, you're probably going to fail. Mm-hmm. I think dictators fail because they're bad dictators. They're bad business people, if you wanted to make an analogous thing to the business world. One of the greatest dictators in our lifetime, although there's plenty of them, was Hitler. What did he do? I believe all dictators fear the military. All of them. They always have. They still do. So what do? If they're a smart, efficient dictator, they build their own, which is exactly what Hitler did. And it was very effective. So I don't know. I don't know if we can... I think that should be taken into account when we try to decide what overcomes authoritarian regimes by, are they a good one or not? Mm-hmm. And if they're a good one, they do some things that pretty much negate a lot of the things that we're talking about. Because they're way ahead of it. And then one last point, which I believe is that what's happening today. I think it was Lenin who said, and excuse me if I don't get the exact numbers right, but he said that if you give me a kid until he's 10 and I'll have him for a lifetime.
Mm-hmm.
I thought
that was a Catholic
church.
That
was the Catholic church until he was 7.
Well,
the Jesuits definitely said
it. Google it. Lenin said it all over the place.
Well, he stole it from the Jesuits.
Who cares? But anyways, the point is there may be some relevancy to that. A madrasa. I believe there are short-term dictators who are poor ones, not very efficient, they don't do well, and if they have a very long-term view and they can educate the children, then it screws up all the parameters here.
Well, so, okay, a couple things on that. First of all, I totally take your point about fear, and all of the campaigns in here were maximalist just to build on that point, which was that all of the regimes were shooting at all of these people. Right. Some of the people reacted by mobilizing using nonviolent resistance, and some of them mobilized by using violent resistance. So all of the people are engaging in very high-risk activity. The second point about whether they're good dictators or not, I was very concerned about this. I have a colleague and mentor named Steve Krasner who says, incompetence is not a very useful social science principle. It's very hard to measure until you see the long-term outcome. Yeah. And you know, one of the things that's very counterintuitive is that actually it's the dictators who have been in power the longest who are most susceptible to this. And so actually it's a little more complex in the sense that if you grow up in a society where all you know is the single dictator, and whether there's been propaganda and whatever is it's usually the case. What happens is that not only do people grow up in that environment, but they also grow up knowing totally where the sort of pressure points are. It's like intuitive to them, even though it wouldn't be to us. They know which person they always bribe, right? That's a pressure point. They know how you need to get mobilized in the society in ways that kind of circumvent the authorities. So actually, the real paradox is the longer these dictatorships are in power, the more capable people are of challenging them, which is kind of counterintuitive. But I think, you know, both of these sides are making strategic choices and often making strategic mistakes. And this speaks to your last point, that in some places in the world, it's going to be really difficult to mobilize nonviolent action. In the same places, it's really difficult to mobilize armed action. Right, so just as hard to try to combat Hitler with armed action as with nonviolent action. Right. And so, I don't see those as places where nonviolent resistance doesn't work relative to armed resistance. I just see those as places where resistance is very difficult.
Yeah. Terrific presentation. Could you elaborate a little bit, given the lack of effectiveness of financial, outside financial assistance?
Yeah.
As a policymaker, would you go a little deeper in terms of what you think we ought to be doing support these movements?
So we used a very blunt and narrow measure because it was all that I felt I could do in the time span that we were given to collect these data. We only looked at direct financial support from a state to the movement. We didn't look at things like INGO support. We looked at sanctions, which actually didn't end up being very effective, but one thing that was very effective is when a patron state removed its support from a regime. So this is like Ronald Reagan calling Ferdinand Marcos and saying, dude, you're on your own. Like, we do not have you in this conflict anymore. That was actually that was the game-changing moment. So, you know, that for a policymaker is really important to know. The U.S. is often extremely, I'd say, reluctant to make statements in moments of political crisis for its key allies in different strategic parts of the world. But it is a very critical component of whether the campaign succeed or not. Another thing is INGOs and NGOs, non-governmental organizations, might be mobilized to support these campaigns. We know that that's powerful because the Russian government just outlawed it. You know, thank you for telling us what you're so scared of, right? So those types of tools might be used more readily by the U.S., which of course is delegating a lot of kind of diplomacy to these groups, but it's sort of happening anyway, and they could definitely be bolstered. The closing of space for civil society is like a big thing in Washington right now, and even like taking a couple years to put a couple people on the idea of like, what can we do to push back against the closing civil society space worldwide? Maria, Stefan, and I, our next project that we've just started is collecting data on all different types of actors, educational groups, civic society groups, diplomats, but also businesses and corporations, and how they supported nonviolent campaigns as third parties, and then at what point in the campaigns. Was it enabling environment? Was it during the peak of the campaign or the transition phase? And then looking at the long-term outcomes. Because there is no empirical data on this at all. And for the time being, if we make any policy, we're sort of flying blind. So that's our next project, and more will be revealed in a couple years.
What's the schedule on that?
Yeah, 2 years.
2 years.
Yeah, sorry we can't go faster.
I was intrigued by the statement you made about sending individuals who have experienced or trained in nonviolence into environments where they could help and advise. I mean, are you advocating a covert insertion of a new special forces in nonviolence?
I don't know that I would want it to be covert, for one thing. I think the way it's been done in the past is fairly overt, which is to most of civil resistance is quite overt. But the idea is simply to have places where these people can be convened, you know, so that are safe. And there are only a couple groups around the world that I know of who are putting activists in contact with one another. One is a group called Canvas, which kind of emerged out of the Serbian revolutionaries against Milosevic. You know, at this point, the world is a different place. And so I think that a lot of you know, their activity has kind of dwindled. But there's another group called Rise, and what they try to do is it's almost like the Kiva.org of civil resistance. They, you sort of put your, you're like, I live in Mongolia and I'm trying to push for reforms and blah, blah, blah. And they try to hook you up with a catalyst who can help you to sort of think strategically through a campaign.
It's called
Rise? Rise, R-H-I-Z-E. And, you know, for me, like, there are just a couple of basic facts that I think if everybody in the world knew these things, it would be good. The first thing is that the average nonviolent campaign takes 3 years to sort of see the political effects. So most people aren't thinking in terms of how do I make a 3-year campaign. They're, you know, if you talk to activists, they'll be like, I'm just thinking about 3 weeks from now. You know, not, they don't have a 3-year strategic plan. Most armed insurgents, by the way, it's 9 years. So it's actually shorter. Another kind of myth buster. And then another thing is, I would like everyone in the world to know that civil resistance is not just demonstrations. And I think that the Arab awakening spread the sort of, it sort of diffused this technique of demonstrations in public squares in a way that's actually hurting movements at this point. Because it kind of transmitted this notion that if we just get 2 million people to populate the streets for 18 days, our dictator will fall. That's exactly the wrong lesson to learn from Egypt and Tunisia. But it's definitely what people took, and I think it's dangerous and it's actually hurting movements now. So just basic knowledge, you know, if we could get that out, and that's lots of different people communicating. You had your hand, and then you too.
Okay. Erica, when did you receive your PhD?
2007.
Seven.
Yeah.
I'm fascinated by the speed of your sort of evolution in your thinking and research about this. And when was the workshop that you referred to?
2006, so it was right toward the end.
Toward the end of that.
And the results of this study came out in 2008.
Okay. You moved very quickly on all of this, and just thinking about the sort of new discoveries and insights is very, very interesting to me. Were you involved in Colored College has a program that was event down there fairly recently? And I met Serja.
Yeah.
Who actually came up here. I met him at the City Club where he was in town.
Oh, good. Good.
So do you know him?
I do.
Okay.
I know him.
I want to be sure that was the case.
Yeah. Yeah. Serge and I have known each other for a while. He just wrote a book called Blueprint for Revolution that has a lot of insights from his work training activists and so forth. It's probably way easier to read than my book. Mine is written for an academic audience and his isn't. I know him, and I think my thinking on this was really, I was very troubled actually by the results because they didn't make any sense to me, and it took me a few months to just even come to terms with it and then to get the courage to write about it because I was afraid that it was so against the grain that people would just think we were stupid and ridiculous. So when you read the book, actually, the reason it's hard to read is because we were so careful at every single stage to explain the sort of skeptic's expectation about each of these assertions that we were going to make. And it really helped that I was so cynical because I knew what they would all be. So the book reads like us arguing against each other, kind of. And I don't know. We have an antagonistic collaboration still. Most of the time we totally disagree with each other. Like Maria's like, let's get the US government on this and like mobilize it. And my hunch is anything the US government touches is going to. So we want to do civil society support, you know. So it's good. And the book reads like two people having an argument. And I think that it makes it better.
You're applying your own principles for your own activism here is what I'm hearing. Very interesting. Just think that contemporary juxtaposition of the theory and research that you've been immersed in such contemporary application is remarkable.
Thanks.
Yeah. I think one of the things that was most surprising to me is the relatively low percentage of a society that has to participate to have an impact. Mm-hmm. I would never have dreamed that it was that low.
That's an old idea, though. That's been around for a very, very long time. The idea that it only takes a few percent to change the whole government. And that's not new at all.
Well, and if you've ever been in a boardroom or any type of community activity, you'll hear, you know, that it doesn't actually take a very large number of people to throw the whole thing, you know. So, but I think The key point, though, is that you're almost never going to get that many people willing to risk without a huge latent body of sympathy and support, which is kind of an important point, too, because I don't want people to come away with the idea that you can just mobilize like 3.5% of the population, not worry about anybody else, because I don't think that would be really what our data say.
Look at Egypt and Tahrir Square.
Right.
It was their women that were there.
Right.
But it was the mothers at home and the sisters at home and the younger population that was behind them supporting them.
In Egypt, they never had the military either. That was a huge, huge factor, and everybody knew it. They did not have the military. The military, and I know why, because I trained with some of them. I know these guys. And so they were familiar with us, and they were not ready to go along with the powers to be there. And so I think that's a big factor, too.
We have these two gentlemen, and then Carolyn and Tatiana.
I can't remember which one of Thomas Friedman's book, maybe it was The World is Flat, he talked about the inverse relationship between the price of oil and democracies around the world. So I guess my first question is, you know, the lower the price of oil, the more democracies are bound to flourish. First, I guess, do you agree with that? Does that hold true? And two, if it does hold true, do you see any signs of that today with the reduced price of oil? Maybe it's not quite as dramatic, where democracy maybe, on an optimistic note, is flourishing more, and there is more nonviolent protests and people getting involved.
Mm-hmm. We're the strategic advisor to Obama next week about the mess with the ISIS going on, which is, in my perspective, an incredibly difficult, complicated situation. Knowing what you know, what general advice might you give him to strategize on how the United States could advise those people stuck in the middle of this caliphate emerging conflict with ISIS to change the situation and get ISIS removed?
Well, I actually had two. I just wanted your sort of feeling about Occupy Wall Street, and I realize that's more of a local or U.S. kind of thing, but what you thought of their mobilization or non-mobilization, so to speak, and then just wondered what impact you think women have on nonviolent demonstrations.
Right. So oil, ISIS, Occupy, and women. let us range across a variety of topics. Okay, so does oil affect democracy? The answer is yes, but not necessarily in terms of global pricing, like Friedman suggests. It's actually more related to domestic politics. And what we know is that extremely oil-wealthy states have a really tough time ever becoming anything other than monarchies or authoritarian regimes. The reason is because of what we call oil rents, which is buying off your military. So if you have a huge amount of basically surplus sovereign wealth, you don't have to tax your citizens. But that also means if you don't tax your citizens, they don't have any leverage over you. And so you basically get to just basically pay them off every time there's any type of political dissent, which demobilizes the population, very much like Saudi Arabia during the Arab Awakening. If you just cut everybody a $10,000 check, they get the message very well, thank you, and they will not. Right, exactly. So keeping the inner entourage close is something that you can do when you have that amount of surplus wealth. The other thing is that usually they maintain power so long by investing that surplus wealth into their repressive apparatus. So they're going to build out a much larger military while simultaneously not investing a lot in things like education and so forth. So you basically disempower the populace, you reinforce your own power base, you pay off your inner entourage, it coup-proofs you, and it makes it very unlikely that you're going to, you know, reform yourself. So that's the argument that I buy, written up by a guy named Michael Ross, who's a UCLA professor. On your question about ISIS, I think, I think of ISIS maybe in kind of a weird way, which is, I don't think that ISIS is a monolith. I think that ISIS actually looks a lot more at this stage like that. In the sense, except without as much of a really central regime leadership, I think there's probably a few chunks. And I think that the pillars of support are people who fall into a number of different kind of recruitment categories. The first category of bird in ISIS is the true believer, So those are people that are just on board with the doctrine, and they're going because they want to be part of the process. Then you have psychopaths. There is a lot of research that shows us that people with psychopathic personality disorder self-select at a higher rate into groups like this than the average group, and that's just the way it is. So the average population of a country has about 1 to 1.5% of its population having psychopathic propensities, and groups like this usually have 3 or 4% of the group membership that way. So that's why you see some people doing like unbelievably crazy things on camera and seemingly really enjoying it. That's probably that person, but that's not everybody in the group. Very small proportion. Then you have people who are opportunists. These are people who see a conflict like this and think, I can like win big on this conflict. If I go there, offer my skills as like an oil smuggling agent or a weapons smuggler or a human trafficker, like, and so that's those, yeah, opportunists are the businessmen. They can gain on this, and so they're drawn to it. And at this point, because of how long they've been around, you also have a large proportion of people who are coerced. And the way this goes down is this. ISIS takes a village, it pulls out all the able-bodied men, it asks the elder of the village, are you with us or are you against us? He says, I'll never support you. They kill him, and they go to the next person and say, are you with us or against us? And they say, I'm with you, of course. At this point, probably the majority of ISIS are people like that. And what that means is that there's lots of opportunity to kind of capitalize on the fact that it's not monolithic, and you have people there for all sorts of different personal reasons, most of them at this point because of short-term survival. Right. So offer them an alternative for long-term survival, and you know there's a possibility that the place fragments. So I think actually, ironically, and this is like totally going against the grain, I think it's better to fight a group that looks more like this than one where, you know, like we just don't know who's in charge or whatever. It's much better to like let them kind of form into a state, because then we know that these players will come out of the woodwork and it'll be much more obvious where the points of pressure are. So this is like my totally I don't live in Washington, D.C. speak. You'd rather fight IS than ISIS. Your question about Occupy, I think that Occupy is, I think there are a couple things. One is that they never mobilized very many people. They mobilized a lot of people, more than the U.S. had mobilized for a long time. The things that really kind of got in the way were, first of all, the movement never actually, as a movement, denounced violence. There were elements of it that did, and then there were elements of it that didn't. And what we know in this country at this time is that people are repelled by scenes that look like chaos and violence. And that's just the reality. So you don't get women staying around, you don't get people of color staying around because they're the ones that always get repressed the worst in those environments. You don't get elderly staying around because they don't want to be involved in street fights. And then you're basically gutting your movement. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that promising in the sense that people were considering all these kind of intersectionalities, as they call them, that, you know, this is a movement for inequality, but it's also because of, you know, patriarchy, kind of capitalism and sexism and all kinds of other elements, racism. They were sort of all in there. And I think that that's more or less fine for a movement if it can kind of figure out a way to structure those different kind of streams coming in a way that focuses them toward a common goal. And the movement actually got kind of torn apart because of those things instead of brought together because of it. And it wasn't ever able to resolve those internal issues. Most movements die over internal issues. I think that in a way, Occupy still made a huge mark. Global inequality and even domestic inequality is on the agenda for the first time ever in a serious way, and that's an impact we shouldn't ignore. And the other thing that it did is it brought together all kinds of different activists from around the country that never would have met ordinarily. So like the Black Lives Matter movement, for example, is so many people who met in Occupy. And, you know, they sort of cut their teeth and like took their lumps and learned their mistakes there and are now mobilizing, I think, in a much more effective way in many contexts. So, you know, there's that piece of if you lose in the short term, but what do you get in the long term? Well, much more capacity, for one thing, for future mobilization. And then on the role of women in nonviolent revolutions, we don't know a ton about it systematically across the empirical data, but I'm actually going to be working with the One Earth Future Foundation on a project where we try to understand how women's participation, whether it actually helps movements maintain nonviolent discipline, and what proportion of like women are necessary in the movement to produce success. So that's a thing that I'm working on for the next year as well. And so if you have me back in like 2 years, I'll tell you what we find out.